All right. So we have a model, a functioning model. It does all what it is supposed to do. But now we need to dig in a little bit into the slow roll conditions that we need in the initial states, such that we have this nearly constant behavior of our field. And therefore, we need to use this condition and investigate a little bit more which kind of constraint is going to, it has to, they have to, which kind of constraints have to be imposed to our field. So how does it has to be, how does it? Behave. Slow roll conditions. And with respect to what we did for dark energy, now we need to go a little bit into more details. So as I said, as we said before, we have our constraint on the effective equation of state parameter, W, which when we use it in our equation of state parameter, right, we have P equal to W rho C square. This is the parametric equation of state parameter. But we want W to be smaller than minus one half. Therefore, we have, minus one third. Therefore, we have this constraint, right? That's what we get. Which means, once we use the pressure and the density expressed in terms of the field, because that's what we are trying to do, given this effective constraint, we want to see what is how this translates into a constraint for our field. For what we get, we just plug in our pressure, which is one half phi dot square. This was our beloved kinetic term minus the potential, so that's this P, smaller than minus one third, and then we have the C squared, and then we have the rho term. So we have one half phi dot squared plus V of phi. Then what we do, we get our phi, we bring it on the other side, and then we have our V, and we bring it on the other side, such that we have on this side only phi dot terms, and on the other side only the potential V, so that we have a relationship, an inequality between the two. And this leads us to just get phi dot squared smaller with respect to V of phi. Then we can also, so we have a constraint, you see, on the kinetic term, so on the time evolution of our field phi. Then what we can do is to basically apply a derivative, so ask ourselves if we, out of this, we can get a constraint on the acceleration of the field. And that's the case, because if we just do the phi squared over the t, what we get is just the derivative of phi squared, of phi dot squared, then we get to phi dot dot, which has to be smaller than the derivative of what we have on the other side. So our dp over the phi in the t. Sorry, the v of phi in the t. Okay, so this is this side of the equation, and this is this side of the equation, where we just applied a time derivative. Okay, that's what we get. So we have that should be phi dot, sorry, phi dot. So what we get, we have these two phi dot that disappeared. Two is a number unity. So next to unity, so in any case, we have our two phi dot dot smaller than the derivative of the potential with respect to the field phi. So
the v with respect to the phi.
And we just define it as phi prime. So if it slips in my on the board, it is prime for the parameters. That's the derivative, not with respect to space or I don't know what, but is the derivative with respect to the potential, because this is the variable of our field, v of phi. Okay, that's our additional constraint that give us the accelerated expansion. Accelerated expansion. So we have a constraint on the field. Then we want, so that's the thing number one, accelerated expansion. Then we want an exponential expansion. And we want our field to evolve initially extremely slow. Slow evolution. Okay? So, how we do it? Well, we have our constraint. Number one and number two. And we just make it sort of extreme. Okay? These are our slow roll conditions. Slow roll conditions, where we don't just want phi dot, so the kinetic term, smaller than the potential, but we want our kinetic term phi dot to be very small with respect to the potential. And then, as well, we want that our acceleration phi dot dot must be very small with respect to the derivative of the potential. Where is the factor of two gone? Well, as I said, is a order unity. So if I put like a 1/2 here or not, it doesn't matter because this is this very small number. This is very small, right, for the inequality. So the factor of two is completely irrelevant. Good. So we have our constraints A and B for the kinetic term and double derivatives of our field here. Then we want our expansion to last long enough. Long enough. The duration must be long enough. It means, remember, that the universe have to inflate by a certain amount. And we characterize this, the amount of inflation, in terms of E-folding number. So the E-folding number, N, is defined as the logarithm of the expansion factor at the end of inflation divided with respect to the logarithm of the expansion factor at the beginning, initial. So the expansion factor when inflation starts to take place, and expansion factor at the end of the inflation. And observations, so this has to be way larger than one, because we want the expansion, as I said, to be dramatic. And the observations tell us that it has to be at least 60. Okay? So 60 E-foldings are enough to explain all what we see. Okay? So this is coming from observations. From what we see. So this is at least. Why it's also nice, this approximation. Look, if this is the case, and if you think at the Klein-Gonon equation, you have your phi dot dot, then you have your term with the phi dot, and then we have the potential. And the potential makes our So the derivative of the potential. So for our this condition, sorry, this one, this condition makes the harmonic component negligible. We go from a second order differential equation to a first order differential equation, which makes our life easier, because they are easier, are easily solved. Okay? And for some potential V, we even get analytical solutions. Okay, it's not that relevant scientifically, because nowadays we can nearly solve everything numerically, but in any case, for a blackboard, it's nice also to have analytical solutions for our equations. Okay? So slow roll conditions. That's the constraint for acceleration, and we make it extreme, such that initially we have the cosmological, the inflaton, which is nearly constant, as well V, nearly constant, behaves as a dark, like a dark energy for our exponential expansion. It lasts long enough. This is how much it has to last to explain our observation. Then I'm going back to that later on. It helps us to go from second to first order differential equation. And for some analytical, for some expression for our potential V, we even get analytical solutions. So that's quite a convenient thing to do, and necessary actually. Nice. So let's now apply this approximation to our equations. The slow roll to our equations. So, first of all, let's give a look at the field, where we have our density. So we have the density of our inflaton field, C squared. It's equal to 1/2 phi dot squared plus V of phi. Then we have the pressure, which is equal 1/2 phi dot square minus V of phi. What happens? It happens that phi dot is negligible. Phi dot is negligible. And therefore, we have that this guy is approximately V, as well as this guy is approximately minus 1. So you see, if we go now for the effective parameter of state, this is behaving as the cosmological constant. It has a cosmological constant-like behavior. The effective parameter of state is roughly minus 1, plus minus, right? Which gives us our accelerated expansion. And as you see, this guy is constant. There is not, it remains nearly constant. So this is from the condition A, okay? This one. Then we go for the dynamics. For the dynamic of which is given by the equation of motion of our universe, which is given by the Friedmann equations. So we have h squared. That is equal, that's not a definition, that's equal to 8 pi g over 3 rho. And we would have the curvature, so kc squared divided a squared. And then we would have, in principle, if we want to be super generic, the cosmological constant or dark energy. Okay? But what happens? we have this crazy amount of e-folding that is taking place. Therefore, very rapidly, the curvature goes to zero. We can forget about this term, becomes negligible. The cosmological constant, or dark energy, we know we build them, I mean, the cosmological constant is negligible at early times, so this would be completely negligible. If we would even think, yeah, there is dark energy initially, again, that guys is going to be negligible because of the slow rolling condition, because initially, also dark energy, is it has a nearly constant behavior. Therefore, also this guy, no matter if you're using lambda or dark energy, these two guys are going to be equal to zero. And you're left with this guy. Then what you do? Well, we are expressing everything in terms of the field. But we know what is the relationship between the density and the field. We have the kinetic term, 1/2 phi dot, and then we have the potential term. Therefore, given these two terms that goes away, can be neglected, we have the initial constant, and then we have our expression for the density of our field expressed in terms of the derivative, so the kinetic term, and the potential phi. Let's call it equation one. Then what? That's the dynamic of the universe, in which the dynamic of the universe, remember that this is A dot divided A, okay, that's how this guy is defined. For you see, this is an equation that tells you how A is going with respect to the density, what is in the universe, and what is in the universe, what is dominating the universe in that epoch, that's the inflaton field. And the density of the inflaton field is this one, okay? Rho of inflaton. So you see, we have a link between A and our inflaton field. Two variables, one equation, not enough. But we also have another equation. So we have two variables, we need another two equations to find them. And actually, what we have the Klein-Gordon equation, so we have the equation of motion for our inflaton field, and we have that equation. Boom, we have everything. We have our phi dot dot plus 3h phi dot plus the derivative with respect to phi of the potential, and this guy is equal to zero. Now, let's apply our slow roll condition. So we have the slow roll condition B. This guy is negligible. We have the slow roll condition A. This guy is negligible. Because as compared to the potential, again, phi dot dot is negligible as compared to the derivative of the potential. Good, two variables, two equations, we can close, the system is closed, we can find our expression. Therefore, I go now with this equation here, equation 2, and I just express phi dot. Phi dot, which is equal to minus phi prime with respect to 3h. So I just isolated this term. I brought v on the other side, so minus phi prime, and 3h again on the other side, and it ends up here. Then I have a relationship with the squared to the kinetic term of my field. Therefore, I go with the square of this one for convenience, because if I go with the square, I get squared 9 squared and power of 2 as well. And I have h to the power of 2 that I can plug in here. Okay, so here we plug equation 1. You see, system of equation, we just put the two equations together. Therefore, what we get is v prime squared over 9 v prime squared 3 c squared over 8 pi g v. We have a 3, we have a 9, it becomes a 3. No, this is already did it, that's the square there. Okay, good. And that's equal to c squared
temperatures here. So we have C squared, the constant, 8 pi g, so these are just all the constants we have, times 3, 3 times 8 it's 24, and then we have the other variables, we have our v squared and we have v. Well, what's that? Phi dot squared. Phi dot squared, which has to be smaller with respect to v. And that's the condition A from our slow roll condition. This is one of the slow roll conditions. Therefore, I define now a parameter, epsilon, which is depends on the field, and I define it as c to the power of 4, 24 pi g v prime over v, way smaller than 1. So you see, I'm starting from v dot. I have an expression with v dot square, which is coming from this equation. I have my h square that is coming from this equation. I plug it in, and I arrive at that. Slow roll condition, E, the first one, give us the constraint that this guy must be smaller than v. Then what I do, I get this guy on the other side, and what is left, I call it epsilon. This is one of the slow roll parameters. We can get another parameter, which is just obtained by getting a derivative with respect to the potential of phi. So you see, epsilon v prime allow us to define another constraint that we call eta, that is defined as c squared 8 pi g v second second divided v. And this has to be way smaller than 1. And so we have two slow roll parameters, epsilon and eta. From here to here, just apply a derivative. Okay, just make the derivative of this guy. See, we already have a smaller than 1, and we arrive at this expression. Okay, that's a trivial step. And that's defined this way. Good. Now, why are they important? Because whenever epsilon is way smaller than 1 and eta is way smaller than 1, then the slow roll is ensured. Slow roll is ensured, and we get all the behavior that we wanted. Accelerated exponential expansion, which is what we need for inflation. Whenever epsilon get order 1 or eta get order 1, then inflations end. End of inflation. Okay? So it's very simple. We just have a constraint on how phi has to behave. One comes from the fact, we start with the fact that we want the acceleration to be, the expansion to be accelerated. This is the condition. We plug in the dependency of pressure and density with respect to the potential phi, which is coming from the energy momentum tensor that we derived earlier. We have this constraint. We just separate the variable phi dot and v, and we obtain the constraint number 1. And if we just apply a derivative of the first guy, you see just derivative of that guy, we arrive at this other condition that constrains the acceleration of the potential with respect to derivative of the, acceleration of the field with respect to derivative, the first derivative of the potential V. Two constraints for our infratone feed. Then what we do, we move on with this slow roll condition that we must impose to have an initial nearly constant behavior for our field, such that we have a nearly like a behavior which is nearly which is mimicking the one of lambda, such as the way our accelerated expansion, which has to be long enough, and this long enough is characterized in terms of e folding, which is just the ratio of the logarithm of the final expansion factor that we get after inflation, and the logarithm of the expansion factor before inflation. And because of observation, to explain flatness and all what I said, this number must be larger than 60, okay? Moreover, we get simpler equation because we have a first order differential equation, and we get, for simple potentials, we get even analytical solutions. And look at our Klein-Gordon equation, you see that we get a nearly like evolution. It's not anymore harmonic because this guy is negligible. So you see, we are left with this term. We don't have an harmonic behavior in this phase of the evolution of our field. Fantastic. Deal with that later. Good. So let's take an example of a potential. Now that we know all the behaviors, the constraint during the inflation epoch, we can be a little bit more practical and see for a specific potential. And for example, we could characterize a free massive field. Free massive scalar field, which is again one of the simplest possible things that we can do. Okay? V of phi, which is equal to 1/2 m to the power of 2 phi squared. Where basically this prefactor, which is the mass of our field, represents the strength of the interaction, the self-interaction. If we take then a derivative of this guy, you see we need a v prime as well there in our constraint for this slow roll condition. So we just get the first derivative, and we have 1/2 m squared, the 2 comes down, phi. 2 and 2 cancel, therefore we have m squared phi. So you see easily we have v, and as well we have v prime, two very trivial equations that then we can use. This model is called the chaotic inflation. And it dates back to 1983. So that's coming from Linde, 1983. Just to give you an historical context. And I will explain you why it's called chaotic. There is a meaning of this name, of course. And it also, you can say, okay, that's very simple, you're making your life easier, but I mean, I want to describe the universe, but maybe it's not the case. Yeah, maybe it's not the case, but remember that we are in a slow roll condition, where we have our phi, our potential v of phi. Here we have a parabolic shape, right? We want an initial slow roll condition, and therefore it's kind of flattish initially, otherwise it would roll too fast, so to say. And therefore, here any kind of potential, you can tailor expand it. You would have a first order with this constant aligned, and then we would have your parabolic shape. Okay, so as well, is a good fit for more general potentials. Okay, Linde was a smart guy. Then we can now define, now that we have something specific to work with, we can look what is the time duration of inflation. such that we can connect our number of e-folding, so how much it has been expanded, to an actual amount of time. So what do? We take again equation 2, right? Our Klein-Gordon equation with the slow roll approximation. Therefore, we are not going to have the harmonic term, the phi dot dot, because this is negligible. We have our terms with the damping factor, 3h, phi dot plus v prime, and that's equal to zero. So what do we do? Well, we do what we did before. We want to have a time rate, which can be easily found, because this is phi dot. Therefore, is d phi on dt. Okay, so you see we can then integrate this expression to find to relate the change of phi to the amount of time t. So now our phi dot, we have our expression here, so that's equal to minus v prime over 3h. So I just wrote this guy on the other side as I did before. We can now characterize again our h. Well, I could have copied up there, but let's do it. So we have 3/8 pi gv. Okay, so that's exactly the expression that I derived before. There is a difference because before there was a phi dot to the power of 2. This is without the power of 2. Okay, that's why there is this square root here popping up, because here I have h, not h squared, as before. And this is going to give us minus b prime 24. This is just, the 3 just goes in. So we have the 3 that goes in, becomes a 9, cancel with this one, and then we have a factor of 3 that becomes a 24. Okay? That's what I did here. 1. And then we can just integrate. You see, I have phi dot, which is this derivative. I can integrate this function with respect to this simple differential equation with respect to time. So integrate. And we get some initial condition for our potential phi minus v prime divided the square root of t pi g v times t. Okay, so the usual bad physical things that physicists do, get this dt and you bring it here. You integrate with respect to the phi, you integrate with respect to dt. That's what you get. Therefore, we can rewrite it as phi dot 1 minus t over tau, where phi e is our initial condition, and tau is defined as phi e over 24 pi gv divided v prime. Okay, so I just grouped basically these quantities with the phi e in this tau. This is unit of time. This is our time scale, okay? That tell us what is the duration of inflation. We can then, you see, we have the potential v, the derivative of the potential v prime, but now we know, because we are using Linde's model, our chaotic inflation, so we can plug in v and v prime in this expression, which leads us to e 12 pi g divided m. So the duration time of inflation depends, is degenerate with respect to the mass of our scalar field and the initial condition phi. When this is the time scale, so this set the time scale of the evolution. You see, we have t over tau, so this sets the time rate, the speed, if you wish, at which the evolution is taking place. And we can ask ourselves, when is the potential, when is the first time that the potential, you know, we have this roll phase, is rolling slowly, but it's rolling, therefore eventually it reaches the zero, right? When does phi goes to zero? Meaning, again, we have our phi, we have our potential, and then it's rolling down. At a certain point, we get phi, we get our situation in which phi is equal to zero, when it reaches the minimum, okay? We can set a zero minimum for our potential. Therefore, we can use our expression, phi dot, in which is going to be zero. So we are asking ourselves when this expression is valid for t equal to zero. And that's equal just to phi e 1 minus t over tau. And you see, this guy is going, this is equal to zero, and we can isolate our time t. So t is equal to tau. The duration of inflation is given by our tau. Okay, these are order of magnitude considerations, and this is just setting the limit, because when we are at this point, we know that we are oscillating. The oscillation is starting. Okay, we have the reheating phase. The field is the field is going to decay. The damping is taking place, so the phi dot dot in our equation of motion for the field, so the Klein-Gordon equation, is an harmonic damping, and inflation ends. End of inflation. Okay? So tau, this guy, tell us when inflation is going to end, how much it has to last. Okay? Next time, now I need to conclude. What we are going to do is to investigate the constraints that we have on the initial conditions. This is next. Okay, let me make a short recap. So, we build up our, in the previous lecture, we build up our model for inflation, so the usual self-interactive scalar field. We looked for the constraint to have acceleration that transforms into this constraint for our field phi with respect to the potential. Taking the time derivative of this expression, we get a constraint for the phi dot dot term, with respect to derivative, with respect to the potential, with respect to the field of the potential. So this is our other constraint that we have. We must impose this low roll condition for the initial phases, because we need a lambda-like behavior such that we have an exponential expansion. And this is the constraint. So these are just these two guys transformed into a very small, not just small. Then we apply, once we have our approximation, we apply it to the properties of our field, and we end up, yes, of course, we get a behavior which is similar to the one in the initial slow rolling phase. We have a behavior which is similar to the one of lambda. We have our beloved exponential expansion. Then we impose our constraint on the dynamics of the universe and of the field, and then we just couple these two equations together, and we end up with this expression, right? This is just the square. This is this equation to the power of 2. We plug in h square, which is coming from here, and we arrive at this expression. But we have the slow roll condition. Phi dot square must be much smaller with respect to v. So what we do, the arrow is wrong here, so it's is the way around. So we have v, we bring in on this side, and what we are going to have here, we call it epsilon. This one. See? Epsilon c square 24 pg v prime over v. Ah, there is a 2 missing here. Okay? Here there is a factor of 2, a power of 2 missing here. Okay? Then we can just play with derivatives, and from this constraint we arrive at this other constraint. T These are the two slow roll parameters that must be fulfilled such that the field is in the slow roll limit. Then what we did, we start to be a little bit more practical, and we specified the potential, and we took this simple, again, a very simple case in which we have a free massive scalar field, which is given by this parabolic, by this parabolic potential introduced by Linde, and we'll tell you next time why it's called chaotic. And you see that it's also a good approximation for any other potential, because in the limit of the slow roll condition, our initial condition must be roughly here, and if you tailor expand another field, then you get something which is closed to this expression. So that's general enough. Then we can look at the time duration. Now that we have a specific potential at hand, we can look at the time duration of inflation, and we just use our Klein-Gordon equation. With our phi dot, we have a relationship between the, how much phi changes with respect to the t. We just integrate this expression, and we find out what is phi, how phi evolves as a function of time. And we realize that this slow roll approximation holds up to the point where the oscillation starts, right? And therefore, we can, as a reference, you know, to have a clear reference, we can take phi equal to zero that we plug in our expression. Well, here, phi equal to zero, that's our expression. We just have a relationship that tells that t is equal to tau. That's our time scale. Therefore, if we look back to how we define tau, we find out that it depends on the initial condition and the mass of the field that we are using. Next time, there was just a little bit left with inflation. Pity that didn't manage to finish today. But in any case, we are going to see what are the initial conditions that are coming up from observation. So we are going to see basically constraints on those numbers. And I'm going to explain you why it's called chaotic inflation. Okay? I will answer you. Good. Need to conclude here. Thank you very much, and I'll see you next time. If you have questions, you can come here. Sorry if I run, but I have a talk. I have to give a talk in 10 minutes. Ah, by the way, if you're interested, the talk is about Euclid. So I'm going to give it at ARI, which is not far from here, and I'm going to explain what Euclid is, how it works, and which kind of cosmological constraint we can get from Euclid.
I just wanted to briefly ask what
yeah.
is the mass of our interferon.
We are talking about something of the order of 13 giga electron volts.
No, but like what is like? It doesn't have a mass field or doesn't have a mass.
Well, you have to think the mass and the term in sort of in an abstract way.
Okay, so it's basically just a coupling.
Exactly, it's just a coupling term.
Okay, so we just name it M. And
exactly, and then you call it mass. Okay.
che abbiamo fatto.